known as Hillel, and Joshua, son of Josedech, made a beginning together with the rest of the people, the priests and the Levites, and all who had come to Jerusalem from the captivity. They appointed the Levites, 20 years old and upward, to have the oversight of the work on the house of the Lord. And Yeshua, with his sons and his kin, and Tabriel and his sons, Bimli and Hodaviah, along with his sons and Hedadad, the Levites, their sons and kin, together took charge of the workers in the house of God. And the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord. The priests and their vestments were stationed to praise the Lord with trumpets, and the Levites, the son of Asaph, with cymbals, according to the directions of King David of Israel. And they sang a psalm to thee, praising and giving thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever towards Israel. And all the people responded with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of families, old people who had seen the first house on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout and the sound of people weeping. But the people shouted so loudly that the sound was heard far away. This is the word of the Lord. Something was up. Alyssa was never waiting to greet me at the door as I came home from time to the office. But she had this look on her face, like she was holding a lot and she was about to burst. With emotions, with tears, with words, I was confused. What was going on? Then I noticed a pregnancy stick in her hand and saw its unambiguous positive results. I was not expecting this. After 18 months of fertility questions and tests, we were pregnant. Our trip to Berlin just a few weeks later had evolved into our baby moon. Our last vacation was just the two of us before we entered a new chapter of our lives. The first ultrasound visit with the doctors the day we got home from Berlin. Our ultrasound began like what I'd seen in the movies. There was jelly on Alyssa's belly, and the monitor was mostly black, interrupted by white that formed the image of what was happening beneath Alyssa's skin. A few minutes in, the ultrasound tech furrowed her brow. How far along are you? 8 weeks, Alyssa replied. And measuring 6 weeks of size. Then came the moment for the heartbeat. Only there was none. I breathed in, but there was no air. The only thing I could do was outstretch my finger and catch the tear that escaped from the corner of Alyssa's eye and ran down her cheek. The ultrasound tech told us we should come back in 2 weeks because maybe we had miscounted and we see a heartbeat at 8 weeks because 6 weeks was a little early for a heartbeat. We knew, though, we hadn't miscounted. We had tracked time and time again. Something else was going on. 2 weeks later, the fetus was about the same size, which confirmed what we already knew. More waiting until we could become parents. This period of waiting continued sitting in the waiting room at West Dallas Memorial Hospital with a bunch of very pregnant women as we waited to meet with our doctor. What had previously been shock and sorrow changed into anger in this waiting room. Being surrounded by large bellies full of new wives felt like a cruel joke at this moment. It was salt in the wound, a reminder of what was not to be. not a diagnostic might be reading over the 2 weeks between ultrasounds, but that half hour in the waiting room, probably the worst part of the whole experience. The doctor, however, was great, provided sympathy, care, and comfort. He also provided encouragement and perspective. After 18 months of wondering if and how Alyssa could get pregnant, he did. This pregnancy wasn't going to work out, but medically speaking, this is a step in the right direction. There was no reason we couldn't have a biological baby. This was more than what we could expect 6 weeks earlier. Today's scripture speaks of the return of the Israelite people from exile in Babylon to the Holy Land. The first thing they did when they got back was rebuild the temple, the house of the Lord, that their Babylonian captors had destroyed. According to the Israelite people, the temple was the place where God's presence dwelled. A great celebration occurred after the temple foundation was laid. Cymbals and shouting and festivities and trumpet sounds. Think of Greg's Happy Trails events, but this one was just for creating a level plot. They all began to praise God, declaring that God is good and God's steadfast love endures forever. News of the temple being rebuilt, though, was creating a mixed reaction. Others still were wailing and lamenting what they had lost, as they again felt the pain of the first time of their temple being no more. Another was full of mixed emotions, and whatever emotions they were feeling, it was a lot. From a distance, all people heard was just a lot of noise and a lot of crying for who knows what. Joy for a new temple, a new beginning, and sorrow for what was lost. As I left the doctor's office that one day in late August, I couldn't tell if he used the words of Ezra 3, I wanted to shout with joy or weep. Whatever I was feeling, it was a lot. It's a bit of my story through this pandemic. We all have our stories throughout the pandemic. Stories of joys and of sorrows, and a lot in between. There's been many a moment over the past 6 months or so, where those in our community, and we haven't been sure if we wanted to cry, to shout with joy, we still couldn't decide between the two. We've been through a lot lately as a church. We've had an incredible 16 years, or just under 16 years, with Pastor Greg. And he's gone now. It's okay to wonder what's coming next. We're back in the building for worship. Some of us since April. Some of us since our first Sunday in the building. But on most Sundays, there's not as many people in physical attendance as there was before COVID struck. We don't all have to feel the same way in this season. As we see in today's story, it's okay to grieve. It's okay to celebrate when others celebrate, and it's okay to switch between the two from moment to moment. We all have our own story through this pandemic. You've heard a bit of mine today as I share my story of miscarriage. All of us, though, have experienced loss in this season. Some of you have gained along the way, though, too. Others of you are just sick and tired of all things COVID and wish we didn't have to have masks on right now. Wherever you're at today, there's space for you here as we worship God together. Wherever you're at today, God is laying a new foundation for us and building a new future for us together. Reflecting on the German reunification after the fall of the Berlin Wall, and tensions within their band, U2's singer Bono wrote lyrics to this song that became one. Its chorus goes, "We're one, but we're not the same. We get to carry each other." I was talking with Alyssa about this song yesterday, she noticed this chorus has three meanings. We're one, but we're not the same. We're united as one, but there's difference in this for unity, and unity in this are different. We all have our own stories over the past 18 months. We're responding our own way to Pastor Greg leaving. We feel differently about COVID, but we're still one. Of course, what else do you mean? Something has happened. We're not the same. We've changed. The sorrow of over 700,000 dead in our country from COVID and assumed ways of life going away and pathways of doing church. I feel like they're more fragile than we've ever been. We're different as individuals and as a country. The last 18 months have changed us. We may be cheering, we may be lamenting. However we feel, still one. We get to carry each other and we get to rebuild a common life together. We still get to carry each other. The gift and a joy to share life with one another through the highs and the lows. We get to carry each other because God has carried us through this past year and a half. Better days are ahead. No, Atonement has a bright future because God has carried us through the past 18 months and will continue to carry us. I know we've got a bright future because we carry each other through our journey together from out on Jamesville to here on Martin Drive, from our time where we were online only to the time where we're also back in our building together. Carry each other from baptisms and confirmations and weddings to death and divorces. You may feel overwhelming at moments. I know I feel overwhelmed by the news of our miscarriage. I've been carried in this season. I've been carried by you and by God. I'm carried by you and with you. But the God who carried the people from Babylon back to the Holy Land, God is carrying us through this. God's God.